Hello friends, this is Vedavati Varkala working in Narayana IAS Academy. We have started a new program called Prelims 2020 Made Easy. In the last class we have seen right how the civil disobedience movement had stopped. The first roundtable conference happened where the Congress did not participate. So Lord Irwin made a pact with Gandhi, which is known as Gandhi-Irwin Pact or Delhi Pact, in which most of the demands from Gandhi were accepted. So Gandhi as a leader withdrew the civil disobedience movement. And we have also seen how was the participation from different sections of the society. Now we will see comparison of civil disobedience movement with non-cooperation movement. The non-cooperation happened around 1920s, right? Now civil disobedience is during 1930s. So how was it different from 10 years back? Civil disobedience movement aimed at complete independence, whereas the non-cooperation movement was against two major reasons, which is of Khilafat reason, Muslims fought for the Turkey issue, and Jallianwala Bagh massacre. In Amritsar, many armed men were brutally killed. So for these two reasons, people came together in non-cooperation movement. But whereas in civil disobedience, the main goal and the motto was Swaraj or complete independence. So we get to see a lot of maturity in the movement. And methods are different in both the movements. See, in civil disobedience movement, it is about breaking the law. If we see, in the Dandi March, Gandhi went from Sabarmati Ashram to break the salt law. Because the salt monopoly was with British government, so to act against the government, they broke the salt law. Whereas in non-cooperation, it is not breaking the law, it is just not following the law. So that is the difference. Breaking in civil disobedience, not following, just not following is in non-cooperation. Third one, the number of students or the lawyers giving up schools and services was comparatively lesser in civil disobedience movement. Whereas if you see in non-cooperation movement, so many lawyers gave up their service and so many people resigned from schools and joined into national colleges. So we see lesser participation of these in civil disobedience. And also in civil disobedience movement, Muslim participation was far lesser when compared to non-cooperation movement. See, in non-cooperation, we have Khilafat issue, right? Where so many Muslims came together, but here there was no such reason. So only the people who are pro-India, who wanted to stay in India, were participating. So the participation is very less. But peasants and the business class were more in civil disobedience when compared to non-cooperation movement. So see, this class, peasant and business class, participated more in civil disobedience. And the number of political prisoners were more in civil disobedience than in non-cooperation. See, obviously, non-cooperation happened during 1920s and Gandhiji came around 1915 into India. So he could influence more and more number of people as the movements and the struggles progressed. So by 1930s, by civil disobedience time, the participation range and the number is more and number of political prisoners became more. And by 1930s, Indian National Congress was organized much more strongly, also with the help of Gandhi's leadership. We saw right how Gandhi wave swept the nation. So INC is comparatively more strong. And next, what happened? The Indian National Congress session in the year 1931 happened at Karachi, which is in Pakistan now. So in that session, Vallabhbhai Patel acted as president. And what is this session memorable for? In that, Gandhi-Irwin Pact was endorsed, which is known as also Delhi Pact, and the goal of Purna Swaraj reiterated. See, if we saw in Lahore session, this session happened in 1929 with Jawaharlal Nehru as the president, where the goal of Purna Swaraj was adopted. So here again, the goal was reiterated in Karachi session. So in this Karachi session, two major resolutions were adopted. And the first one is about fundamental rights. They talked about the freedom of speech, press, assembly, and about right to vote, which is adult franchise, equal legal rights, secularism, press, free and compulsory education, and protection to culture, protection to script. Like this, they talked about fundamental rights. And the second resolution is about national economic program. So in that, they talked from economic angle, which is about reduction of payment of rent, reduction of giving revenue, relief from indebtedness, better conditions of work and right to workers and peasants and state ownership of key industries and also state ownership of mines and means of transport, etc. So by talking about all these, for the first time, it spelled out the actual meaning of Swaraj for the masses. See, now they are asking for the ownership, reduction of payment of rent and revenue, right? So they are asking for the administrative control and political power also. So this is the actual meaning of Swaraj for the then people. Now, what was the change in the government's attitude during 1930s? See, mass mobilization was happening. People were talking about Swaraj and the Congress was talking about political power and administrative power. The government was thinking that they will not allow Gandhi to start a mass movement again. Because by this time, they know that if a movement happens again on a large scale like this, they'll absolutely lose the control and power of the country. So they're making sure that Gandhi won't take leadership and start a movement again. And now the goodwill of Indian National Congress is not needed anymore because the British by this time had other loyalists in and out of it. So that divide and rule policy, they were thinking of this, how to use other loyalists to act against the Congress. And they wanted to make sure that the national movement will not be allowed to consolidate in the rural areas. Because from this, many number of masses are coming into the political sphere, right, onto the national platform. So they wanted to make sure not to consolidate the movement in rural areas specially. So this was the change in government's attitude. And the next important event was second roundtable conference. That happened in 1931 December. The first roundtable conference happened from November 1930 to Jan 1931. And here the second roundtable conference happened in December 1931. If you remember, Congress and Gandhi did not attend the first roundtable conference, but Muslim League attended. And then Gandhi-Irwin Pact happened, right? Civil disobedience movement was withdrawn. Now, in second roundtable conference, Gandhi and Congress attended. But nothing much happened in this also. The talks failed again. What are the reasons for the failing of talks? There was opposition from the Conservative Party under the leadership of Churchill. Also, the princes were not so enthusiastic in forming a federation. They are not interested to come together and form a federation. Who? All the princes from princely states. And majority participants were loyalists and government was using them against Indian National Congress. So if a demand is put forward by the Congress, the government used this divide and rule, used its loyalists to say something against the Congress. So that's why nothing much qualitative talk happened. And the session got deadlocked on the issue of minorities. Why? Separate electorates were demanded by different sections. Like Muslims were asking for it, Anglo-Indians were asking for it, Christians were asking for it, and now the depressed classes were also asking for minority status. So Gandhi was absolutely against this and the session got deadlocked. So after the talks, what was the result of it? At the end of the session, Ramsay MacDonald announced that two majority Muslim provinces will be formed. That is Northwest Frontier Province and Sindh. This is to appease the Muslims. And also to set up Indian Consultative Committee. And along with that, three expert committees will be formed, each on a different issue. One is on finance, one is on franchise, and other is on states. So Ramsay announced all these committees to be forming. And the fourth important announcement was communal award. We will now see what is this communal award. So this communal award was given by Ramsay MacDonald in 1932. So in the second roundtable conference, he announced, right, that he will be giving a communal award. So that was it. And this is yet another expression of divide and rule policy of British. See, if we see, by that time, Muslims, Sikhs and Christians, these three were already recognized as minorities. Now, even the depressed classes were also considered minority and will be given separate electorate. So that was given in communal award. So it's about depressed classes. The Indian National Congress, they disagreed to support it without the consent of minorities. First, they wanted to ask minorities that will they really need separate electorate? Do they separately want to participate in elections? So they neither rejected it, they neither accepted it. They wanted to talk it out first. Whereas Gandhi, he absolutely opposed it. He saw it as an attack on Indian unity and nationalism. He firmly believed that if depressed class has to be seen separate from Hinduism, then it is better to abolish untouchability as a whole. But depressed classes are not separate from Hinduism, they are part of it. So Gandhi agreed for the reserved seats in the joint electorate, but he is absolutely against separate electorate. That's why he went for indefinite fasting. See, this is important. Whenever Gandhi has to do something for sure, if he wanted some result, he will go for fasting, because he knows that if he goes for fasting, many people will come together, talk about the issue and then bring something concrete. So, against the separate electorate for depressed classes, Gandhiji went for indefinite fasting. But Ambedkar gave his strongest support for the communal award. Now, he is in favorable for the separate electorate for depressed classes. We see Ambedkar, he also came from a depressed class. So, he fought so much for the welfare of these classes. Actually, both Gandhiji and Ambedkar, they are both trying for the welfare of Harijan community, the depressed class only. But it's just the viewpoint and the ideology is different. Gandhiji thought if separate electorates are given, the depressed class will be totally separated. They will be alienated. They will be treated as a separate community. That's why he wanted joint electorate for them with reservations. Whereas Ambedkar thought if separate electorate is given, their needs will be better addressed. Their demands will be listened to. So it's just the difference in viewpoint.